Epistles by Plato, translated by George Burges. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Jeffrey Edwards. Epistle 1. Dion to Dionysius, Prosperity. While I was passing so long a time with you, and administering the affairs of your kingdom the most faithfully of all who took in hand your interests, I had to endure calumnies really grievous, for I know that nothing of a rather cruel kind you ever thought proper to do with my consent, and of this all who have taken a part in the state with yourself are my witnesses, with many of whom I have been engaged in a contest after I had freed them from no trifling calamities, and when in possession of the sole power I had often preserved for you the state. I have been sent away in a more ignominious manner than it became you to drive out a beggar, and you have ordered me to sail away after I had resided with you for such a length of time. With regard to my future conduct, I shall consult my interest somewhat more like a human being, while you, a tyrant of that kind, shall live alone. As to the splendid gold which you gave for my departure, Bacchaeus, the bearer of this epistle, brings it back, for it was neither sufficient for my traveling expenses, nor useful for the rest of life, and it would bring the greatest disgrace upon you as the giver, and not much less upon me as the receiver. But it evidently makes no difference to you, either to give or receive as much gold as this, so that after getting it again, prove by it your attention to some other of your associates, as you did to me, for you have paid sufficiently an attention to me. And now one may mention opportunely the sentiment of Euripides, that when thy affairs shall otherwise fall out, thou wilt pray that such a man were standing by thee. But I wish to remind you that the majority of other tragic poets, when they introduce a tyrant dying at the hands of anyone, make him call out, "By friends deserted, do I hapless perish?" But no one represents a tyrant perishing through the want of gold. To those, too, who possess any mind, that piece of poetry is thought to be not ill said. Not glittering gold amongst men most rare during a life of hapless care, nor steel, nor couch, with silver dight by mortals valued, strike the sight, nor fertile furrows of the earth's wide plain such self-sufficient power e'er obtain, as of good men the mind that thinks the same. Fare thee well, and know that thou hast erred thus much as regards us, in order that you may conduct yourself better towards others. Epistle 2. Plato to Dionysius, Prosperity. I have heard from Archidamus that you think that not only I ought to keep quiet myself, but my familiar friends likewise on matters relating to yourself, and neither do or say anything to your disparagement, but that you make an exception in the case of Dion. Now, this assertion that Dion is to be accepted signifies that I have no power over my connections, for if I had a power as well over others as you and Dion, a greater good would be the result, both to all of you and the rest of the Greeks, as I assert. But now I am great through rendering myself a follower of the dictates of my reason, and this I say because Cratistolus and Polixenus have not given you sound information, for one of them asserted, says common report, that he had heard at Olympia of many of my associates having spoken ill of you, but perhaps he heard more acutely than I did, for such a thing I have not heard. But it is requisite, as it seems to me, for you to act thus for the future, whenever anyone says anything about any one of us, by sending a letter to inquire of myself, for I shall neither be afraid or ashamed to tell the truth. But to you and me, such is the state of circumstances with regard to each other, that we are neither of us unknown to anyone, so to say, of the Greeks, nor is our intercourse passed over in silence, nor let it be concealed from you that it will not be passed over in silence in the time to come, so many have obtained a knowledge of it as having been neither little nor quietly carried on. But why do I say this? I will now tell you, beginning from events far back. Intellect and great power naturally tend to the same, and these two always pursue and seek after and unite with each other. In the next place, men are delighted to speak about these subjects themselves, and to hear about them from others in their private conversations, or in the writings of poets. Thus, for example, when persons discourse about Hera and Pausanias the Lacedaemonian, they are delighted in bringing forward the intercourse of Simonides with these men, and what he did and said to them, and they are accustomed to celebrate together Periander of Corinth, and Thales of Miletus, and Pericles, and Anaxagoras, and Croesus, and Solon, as being men of wisdom, and Cyrus a person of power. Poets, too, in imitation of this, bring together Creon and Tiresias, Polydus and Minos, Agamemnon and Nestor, Ulysses and Palamedes, and, as it appears to me, for the same reason, the first men brought together Prometheus and Zeus, and they sing of some of these as having a difference, and others a friendship with each other, and again of some as having at one time a difference, and at another friendship, and having similar feelings on some points, and different upon others. Now, all these things I mention, as being willing to show that men will not be silent respecting us when we are dead, so that we ought to pay an attention to them. For we must, as it seems, pay some regard even to the time to come, especially since it happens that the most slave-like persons do, by a kind of nature, neglect it entirely. But persons of a more elegant mind do everything in order that they may be spoken well of hereafter. And this I consider an argument that the dead have a certain perception of things here. For the most excellent minds divine that this is so, but the most depraved deny it. Now, the divinations of godlike men are of greater weight than of those who are not so. And I conceive that if it were permitted for those persons of a former age, to whom I am alluding, to correct aught in their intercourse, they would earnestly endeavor that better things be said of them than at present. This, however, it is still permitted us to say, God willing, that if anything has been done not correctly during our former intercourse, either in word or deed, we may correct it. For on the subject of philosophy, I assert that a true opinion will be formed of us, a better one if we are persons of worth, but the contrary if we are worthless. And indeed, if we pay attention to this, we shall not do anything more pious, nor anything more impious if we neglect it. But how this ought to take place, and how it is just, I will explain. When I came to Sicily, I had the reputation of excelling very much in philosophy, and I wished, on my arrival at Syracuse, to have you a witness in my favor, in order that philosophy might be honored by the multitude. But this did not turn out prosperously. I do not, however, assign that as the reason which the many would say, but because you appeared unwilling to put implicit confidence in me, but willing to send me away, and to send for others, and to inquire what my business was, by this, as it seems, distrusting me. And they, who were proclaiming loudly these matters, were many, affirming that you had a contempt for myself, and were seriously applying yourself to other things. Such were the reports at that time bruited about. Now, hear what after this it is just to do, in order that I may reply to your question, how you and I ought to conduct ourselves to each other. If, then, you have a contempt for philosophy, bid farewell to it. But if you have heard from another, or discovered yourself anything more excellent than what you have from me, honor it. But if what you have heard from me please you, then must you honor highly myself likewise. Now, therefore, as from the beginning, do you lead, and I will follow. For being honored by you, I will honor you in return, but not being honored, I shall keep quiet. Further still, if by honoring me you take the lead in this, you will seem to honor philosophy, and that very thing which you are considering, even otherwise, will bring you the reputation of being considered by the multitude a philosopher. But by honoring you, when not honoring me, I should seem to be admiring and pursuing wealth, but this, we know, has a name dishonorable amongst all men. And, to sum up, by your honoring me, there will be an ornament to both of us, but by my honoring you, a disgrace to both. And thus much on these matters. But the little sphere does not answer, and this Archidemus will show you when he arrives. Moreover, you must explain to him very distinctly respecting the matter, which is far more honorable and divine than this, and respecting which you sent as being in doubt. For you say, according to his report, that there has not been a sufficient demonstration respecting the nature of the first. I must speak to you by enigmas, in order that, should the tablet meet with any accident in its folds by land or sea, he who reads it may not understand, for such is the case. As regards the king of all things are his, and all are for his sake, and he is the cause of all that is beautiful. But about a second are the secondary things, and about a third the third. Now the soul of man is eager to learn respecting these things of what kind they are, looking to what is allied to itself, none of which it possesses sufficiently. But respecting the king himself and those of which I have spoken, there is nothing of this kind. But of that which is after this does the soul speak. But of what kind, son of Dionysius and Doris, is your inquiry concerning what is the cause of all things evil? Or rather, is it not a kind of labor throes on this point, which are produced in the soul, and which, if a person does not take away from it, the soul will never meet with truth existing in reality? And you told me that you had thought of this in the garden under the laurel trees, and that it was your discovery. And I said that if this appeared to you to be the case, you had freed me from a long discussion. I said, however, that I had never met with any other person who had discovered it, but that it had been a great source of trouble to myself. But perhaps you have heard this from someone, but accidentally impelled in this direction by a divine allotment, you have not kept firm hold of the demonstrations on this point, and pinned them down. But you are dashing on, at one time in this way, and at another in a different way, to what is the object of fancy, but such it is not. Nor has this occurred to you alone. But be well assured that no one, when he first hears me, is otherwise affected than thus in the beginning. And one having more trouble, and another less, are with difficulty liberated from it, but nearly all of them have of it not a little. Such, then, having been, and is still the case, we have, in my opinion, nearly discovered that about which you sent me, namely, how we ought to be affected towards each other. For, since you are testing my doctrines by associating with other persons and placing them by the side of those promulgated by others, and considering them by themselves, they will, if the touchstone be true, still stick to you, and you will be at home with them and us. How, then, shall these things, and all we have spoken of, not take place? You have, therefore, done well in having sent Archidemus, and, hereafter, when he shall have reached you, and told you my message, other doubts will perhaps lay hold of you. If, then, you take counsel of yourself properly, you will send Archidemus to me again, and he, like a traveling trader, will return again to you. And if you do this twice or thrice, and test sufficiently what is sent from me, I shall wonder if your former doubts be not very different from what they are now. Act, then, thus boldly, for neither will you send, nor Archidemus act the part of a traveling trader in a manner more beautiful or more acceptable to the deity than by a trading of this kind. Be careful, however, that these things do not fall peradventure among men devoid of instruction, for, as it appears to me, there are scarcely any doctrines which will appear more ridiculous to the multitude than these, nor, on the other hand, any more wonderful, and producing a greater enthusiasm in those who are well disposed. But when they are often mentioned and continually heard, and this for many years, they are scarcely at length, and with great labor, purified like gold. But here, what is wonderful there? For even a good many persons have heard these things who are able to learn and able to remember, and, after testing everything in every way, to come to a decision, being already old men, and who have heard these things for not less than 30 years, and who asserted lately that what formerly appeared to them to be the least worthy of belief now appears the most so, and perfectly clear. But what was most worthy of belief then is the very reverse now. Directing, therefore, your mind to this, be careful, lest it repent you of what has now unworthily fallen from you. Now, the greatest guard in this case is in not writing but learning, for what is written, it cannot be but that it will get abroad. On this account, then, I have never at any time written anything about them, nor is there any composition of Plato by name, nor will there be. But what has now been said belonged to Socrates, who was, even when young, a handsome person. Fare thee well, and be persuaded by me, and, after frequently reading this epistle, burn it, and thus much on these matters. With respect to Polixenus, you have wondered that I did not send him to you, but I say now, as of old, respecting Lycophron, and the others who are with you, that both naturally and from the method of your discourse, you very much excel them in the art of speaking, nor is any one of them confuted willingly, as some suppose, but unwillingly, and you appear indeed to have treated them with great moderation, and to have bestowed upon them honorable presents. So much on these matters, which for such matters is much. But if you make use of Philistion at all, make a great use of him, and if you can, lend Speusippus something, and send him away. Speusippus, too, stands in need of you, and Philistion, too, promised me that he would very willingly come to Athens if you would dismiss him. You have likewise done well in dismissing him from the stone quarries. But trifling is the request, both respecting his domestics, and Hegesippus, the son of Ariston, for you sent word to me that if anyone injured either him or them, and you knew of it, you would not overlook it. And of Lucyclides it is worth while to speak the truth, for he alone of those who came from Sicily to Athens has caused no change as regards our intercourse with each other, but ever continues to say something good, and what is for the best respecting what has occurred. Epistle 3. Plato to Dionysius. Having put in a letter, all hail, can I have truly found the best address, or rather by writing, according to my custom, prosperity, as I am accustomed to address friends in my letters. For you, as they who went on a sacred embassy related, addressed the god at Delphi by this very flattering expression, and wrote, as they say, hail, and preserve the tyrant's pleasant life. But I would exhort not even a man, much less a deity, by an invocation to do this, not a deity because I should give a command contrary to his nature, since the deity is seated far from pleasure and pain, nor a man because pleasure frequently begets mischief, and pain produces in the soul indocility and forgetfulness and silliness and insolence. And thus much let it be said by me on the subject of the address. And do you, after having read this, receive it as you are willing to receive it. Not a few report that you stated to certain persons sent to you that when I heard you saying that you were about to establish Grecian cities in Sicily and to relieve the people of Syracuse by changing the government from an absolute to a limited monarchy, I prevented you from doing so, although, as you assert, you were very eager on the matter, but that now I have taught Dion to do the very same thing himself, and that, according to your notions, we are depriving you of your power. You indeed know whether you are benefited by such assertions. You are, however, injuring me by stating the contrary to what really occurred, for I have been sufficiently prejudiced by Philistades and many others in the eyes of the hired troops and the mob of Syracuse, through my remaining in the Acropolis, while they without, I think, would, had any error taken place, have turned it all against myself, by asserting tenaciously that you were persuaded in all things by me. But you knew yourself most clearly that of my own accord I meddled very little with politics, except at first when I thought I might do something beneficial, and that I was moderately engaged in some other trifling matters and upon the proems of the laws, with the exception of what you and someone else have written as an addition, for I hear that some persons after you have been tampering with them. Each portion will, however, be plain to those who are able to distinguish my manner. But, as I just now said, I do not stand in need of calumny before the Syracusans and certain others, if you can persuade them by speaking in this way. But I am much more in want of an apology against the former calumny and that which has now been produced after it, both greater and more violent. Against these two calumnies, therefore, it is necessary for me to make a twofold apology by saying, in the first place, that I properly avoided taking a share with you in the affairs of the city, and in the second place, that I know it was not my advice, as you have asserted, that exhorted you, nor was I an impediment to you when about to establish the Grecian cities. Hear then first the commencement of those matters about which I have spoken the first. I came to Syracuse, invited by yourself and Dion, who had already passed an ordeal with me, and had been of old my guest, and who was of the middle and staid period of life, men of whom there is altogether a need to such as possess even a little intellect when they are about to consult about affairs such as yours were then, while you were very young, and had great inexperience on those points in which it behoved you to have been skilled, and you were perfectly unknown to me. After this, some man, or God, or fortune, did in conjunction with yourself drive out Dion, and you were left alone. Think you then, at that time, I would have held any communion with you on affairs of state, when I had lost a sensible partner? And when I saw a senseless person was left with many and wicked men, not ruling in reality, but fancying himself to be a ruler, although he was ruled over by men of such a kind? Under these circumstances, what ought I to have done? Is it not of necessity, from what occurred afterwards, just what I did do, to bid farewell to state affairs, and to be cautious of the calumnies arising from envy, and to endeavor to make all of you, although separated and at variance, friends as much as possible to each other? End of this, you are the witness, that in bringing this about I never abated a jot, and, though with some difficulty, it was nevertheless agreed that I should sail homewards, since a war detained you, but that, when peace took place, I and Dion should come to Syracuse again, and that you should invite us. Such were the circumstances that occurred, touching my first sojourn at Syracuse, and of my safe return home. On peace being made, you invited me a second time, not, however, according to the agreement, but you wrote to me to come alone, and said that you would send for Dion afterwards. On this account I did not come, and displeased Dion, for he thought it would be better to come and hearken to you. In a year after this a trireme arrived, and letters from yourself, and the language of the letter began by saying that if I would come, the affairs of Dion should be settled according to my mind, but the contrary if I did not come. I am ashamed to say how many letters then came, both from you and others through you, from Italy and Sicily, to myself, and to such as were my relations and acquaintances, all of them exhorting me to go, and begging me by all means to yield to your request. It seemed therefore good to all, beginning from Dion, that I should set sail, and not act the coward. And yet I put forward before them my period of life, and I strenuously urged, with respect to yourself, that you would be unable to defend me against those calumniating us, and wishing us to become foes. for I saw then, and I see now, that the great and overswollen property of private persons, and almost monarchs, that the greater they are, the more do they nourish calumniators, many and mighty, and who associate for the sake of pleasure, together with mischief of a shameful kind, an evil greater than which neither does wealth produce, nor the influence of any other power. Bidding, however, farewell to all these ideas, I came, after thoroughly reflecting, that not one of my friends would have to accuse me in that, through my negligence, their interests had been, when they might have been safe, destroyed. On my arrival, for surely you know all that occurred thereupon, I thought it right, according to the compact made in your letters, that you should in the first place bring back Dion and restore him to your familiar intercourse. Such familiar intercourse, I mean, as that, by which, if you had been persuaded by me, something better than what has taken place would have happened to yourself, and Syracuse, and the rest of the Greeks, at least, as my opinion divines. And then I thought it right that the relations of Dion should have his property, and that those whom you know did divide it should not have divided it. Moreover, I thought that what was customary should be sent to him each year, and rather more, and not less, be sent on account of my being present. But succeeding in none of these demands, I determined to depart. After this, however, you persuaded me to remain a year, by saying that you would sell all the property of Dion, and send one half to Corinth, and leave the residue to his son. I could relate many other things, not one of which, after promising, you have performed, but on account of their multitude, I will cut them short. For, after you had sold all the property of Dion, without having persuaded him to that step, although you said you would not do so, without first persuading him, you have put, O wonderful man, a most glorious finish to all your promises. For, you discovered a plan, neither honorable, nor clever, nor just, nor advantageous, to frighten me, as being ignorant of what had taken place at that time, in order that I might not require the money to be sent. For, when you were intending to banish Heraclides, an act that did not seem just to the Syracusans, or to myself, and on that I did, together with Theodotos and Eurybius, request you not to do so, you laid hold of this as a sufficient pretext, and said that I had evidently been for some time past caring nothing for you, but only for Dion and his friends and relatives, and that since Theodotos and Heraclides are now calumniated as being the relatives of Dion, I am devising in every way for them not to suffer punishment. And thus much on the subject of the intercourse between you and myself on state affairs. And if you have seen any estrangement in me towards yourself, think it only reasonable for all this to have happened in this way, and do not wonder at it, for to anyone possessing any intellect I should justly appear to be a knave, if I were induced by the greatness of your power to betray an old friend and guest, when, doing badly through you, and being, so to say, not inferior to yourself, and to prefer you, when committing an act of injustice, and to do whatever you ordered, for the sake, it is evident, of money. For no other reason would any one have assigned for this change in me, if changed I had been. But these events, occurring in this way, have through yourself produced a kind of wolf friendship, and a want of cordiality between you and me. The discourse has now come nearly to the point connected with what has just now occurred, and for which I said I must in the second place apologize. Attend, therefore, diligently, and consider whether I appear to you to tell a falsehood and not the truth. For I assert that you did, when Archidemus and Aristocritus were present in the garden, about 20 days before my departure homewards from Syracuse, find fault with me on the points you have just now mentioned, how that I was more concerned for Heraclides and all the rest than for you, and you likewise asked me in their presence whether I remembered that on my first coming to Syracuse I exhorted you to establish the Grecian cities, and I acknowledge that I did remember, and even now it appears to me that it is best to do so. I must likewise relate, Dionysius, what was said at that time after this, for I asked you whether I advised you to do this alone, or something else besides this, but you answered me in a very angry and insulting manner, as you thought, and on this account the insult of that period has become a daydream instead of a night one. For you said, laughing in not a feigned manner, if I remembered, that you had exhorted me, after I had been instructed, to do all these things or not. I replied that you had very properly reminded me. You then said, was it after being instructed in geometry, or how? After this, I did not say what it came into my mind to say, through the fear that, on account of a trifling word, the sailing away which I expected would be in a narrow instead of a wide space. This, then, is for the sake of all what has been said by me. Do not calumniate me by saying that I did not permit you to colonize the Grecian cities subverted by the barbarians, and to assist the Syracusans by your changing to a limited monarchy instead of an absolute one. For you cannot state any falsehood against me which is less suited to myself than this. If there appeared to be anywhere a sufficient power of deciding, I could give, in addition to these, arguments still clearer to prove that I exhorted you to act in this way, but that you were unwilling to do so. And, in truth, it is not difficult to show clearly that, had this been done, it would have been the best for yourself, the Syracusians, and all the Sicilians. If, then, you deny you have said so, after you had so said, I have a right of action against you. But, if you confess you did say so, consider, after this, that Stesichorus was a wise man, and, imitating his recantation, betake yourself from a false assertion to a true one. Epistle 4. Plato to Dion of Syracuse. Prosperity. I think that my readiness with respect to events as they occur is apparent at all times, and that I give much of a serious attention to their being brought to pass for the sake of nothing else rather than a love of honor in the case of things honorable. For I consider it just that they, who are in good truth worthy men, and who act in this manner, should obtain the renown due to them. At present, matters are, to speak with God's will, doing well. But in those that relate to the future, there is the greatest contest. For to excel in fortitude, swiftness, and strength would seem to be in the power of some others. But to excel all the others in truth, justice, magnificence, and the graceful bearing relating to all these, any one would agree to honor in reason those who establish their claim to qualities such as these. Now then, what I am saying is manifest, but at the same time we ought to remind ourselves that it is proper to excel the rest of men whom you know more than boys. Hence we ought to become manifest as being such as we say, especially since, so to say, with God's will be easy. For to others it has happened that it was necessary for them to have wandered in many a place, if they were about to be known. But that which is now existing about you is such, so that persons from the whole of the inhabited earth, if one may speak in rather an arrogant style, are looking to one spot, and in that spot to yourself especially. Since then you are beheld by all men, prepare to exhibit yourself as that celebrated Lycurgus of the olden time, and Cyrus, and if there is anyone else who has ever been thought to excel in moral and political virtues, especially since many, and indeed nearly all here say, there is a great expectation that, when Dionysius is taken off, affairs will be in a ruinous state through the ambition of yourself, and Heraclides, and Theodotus, and others of your acquaintances. Let, then, the most of all, such a person not exist. But if he should exist, do you appear as a healer, and ye will proceed on to what is best. It appears perhaps to you ridiculous for me to mention these things, because you are yourself not ignorant of them. But I see that in the theatres the combatants are incited by children, to say nothing of their friends, whom one might suppose would, through a kind feeling, cheer them on with earnestness. Now then, do you enter the contest, and send me word by a letter if you require at all my assistance. Affairs are here very nearly as when you were present. Inform me, too, what has been done, or what you are now doing, for, though we hear many things, we know nothing. And now, letters from Theodotus and Heraclides have come to Lacedaemon and Aegina, but we, as has been stated, although we hear many things about those here, know nothing. Bear in mind that you seem to some to be less attentive than is fitting. Let it therefore not escape you that by pleasing men it is possible to do something, but that austerity has its dwelling in a desert. May good fortune be thine. Epistle 5. Dion to Perdiccas. Prosperity. I have advised Euphrius, as you enjoined in your letter, to occupy himself about all that is a care to you, and I am justified in giving you advice suited to a host, and what is called holy, respecting the other things of which you may speak, and how you ought for the present to make use of Euphrius. For the man is useful in many ways, but mostly so in that where you are, through your time of life, deficient, and through there not being many counselors of the young on that point. Now there is a voice from each form of polity, as it were from certain animals, one from a democracy, another from an oligarchy, and another again from a monarchy. Very many persons assert that they understand these voices, but except a few, they are very far from understanding them. Whichever, then, of these polities speaks with its own voice, both to gods and men, and produces actions correspondent to its voice, it flourishes ever, and is preserved. But when it imitates another voice, it is destroyed. For this point, then, Euphrius will be useful to you in no small degree, although he is possessed of fortitude in other things likewise. For I hope that he will discover the reasons for a monarchy, not less than those who are in your employment. If, then, you make use of him for this purpose, you will be benefited yourself, and greatly benefit him. But if any one on hearing this should say, Plato, as it seems, professed indeed to know what is conducive to a democracy, but though he might have spoken amongst the people and given them the best advice, yet he never got up and addressed them, to this it may be said that Plato was born late in his paternal land, and that he came amongst a people already grown rather old, and accustomed by those prior to him to do things contrary to his advice, for he would have consulted most willingly for its good, as for that of his own father, had he not thought he should vainly expose himself to danger. And I think he would do the same thing with respect to my advice, for if we should appear to be incurable, he will bid a long farewell to us, and will abstain from advising either me or mine. May good fortune be thine. Epistle 6. Plato to Hermias, Erastus, and Coriscus. Prosperity. It appears to me that some god has kindly and abundantly procured for you good fortune, if you will only receive it properly. For you live neighbors to each other, and have need to benefit each other in the greatest degree. To Hermias I say that neither a multitude of horses, nor of any other alliance for war, nor of gold present to him, would be of greater power for every emergency than of friends who are firm and possess a sound moral conduct. But to Erastus and Coriscus I say, although I am an old man, that besides the beautiful wisdom relating to species, there is a need of that wisdom which possesses a guardian and defensive power against the base and unjust. For they are inexperienced through their having passed much of their life with us, who are men of moderation and without guile. On this account I have said that they stand in need of those two things in order that they may not be compelled to neglect true wisdom and pay more attention than is proper to human and necessary wisdom. But Hermias appears to me to have received this power from nature, which is not yet cognate, and from art through experience. What, then, do I say? To you, Hermias, do I, having made a greater trial of Erastus and Coriscus than you have, assert, indicate, and testify that you will not easily find habits more worthy of confidence than those of your neighbors. I advise you, therefore, to hold to yourself, by every honest means, men of such kind, nor to consider it an act of secondary moment. And, on the other hand, I advise Erastus and Coriscus to stick close to Hermias, and to endeavor, by such grapplings with each other, to arrive at one common bond of friendship. But if any one of you shall determine to dissolve this union, for human affairs are not altogether stable, send hither to me and my friends an accusing letter of blame. For I think that the reasons sent by those here, and based on justice and a feeling of respect, will, unless the rupture happens to have been very great, weld and bind you together better than any incantation into your pre-existing friendship and communion, by which, if all, both we and you, philosophize as far as we are able, and it is permitted to each, what has now been oracularly delivered, will be ratified. But I will not say the same, should we not act in this manner, for I define a good omen, and I say that if a god is willing, you will do all good deeds. It is requisite for you to read this letter, all three together, but if not, two in common, as often as you can, and, as it is possible, and to make use of a compact and a decisive law, which is indeed a just thing, and at the same time taking an oath, with attention, not devoid of taste, and amusement, the sister of attention, and swearing by the God, who is the ruler of all things present and future, and by the Father and Lord of the ruler and cause, whom, if we philosophize truly, we shall all clearly know, as far as is possible for men under a good genius. Epistle 7. Plato to the kindred and friends of Dion. Prosperity. Ye have written to me that I ought to think your sentiments are the same as those which Dion held, and, moreover, you exhort me to make a common cause, as far as I can, in word and deed. If ye have the same opinion and desires with him, I agree to unite with you, but if not, to take frequent counsel with myself. Now, what his sentiments and desires were, I can tell pretty nearly, not by conjecture, but by having known them clearly. For, when I came originally to Syracuse, being then nearly 40 years old, Dion was of the age that Hipparinus is now, and the opinion he then held he has still continued to hold, namely, that the Syracusans ought to be free and live according to the best laws, so that it is by no means wonderful if some god has caused the latter to agree in the same opinion with the former on the subject of a polity. But what was the method of producing this is a thing not unworthy for the young and not young to hear, and I will endeavor to relate it to you from the beginning, for the present events offer the opportunity. When I was a young man, I was affected, as the many are. I thought, if I became quickly my own master, to betake myself immediately to the public affairs of the state. Now, some such circumstances as these fell out relating to state affairs. Of the polity existing at that time, when it was abused by many, a change took place, and, over the change, 150 men presided as governors, 11 in the city, and 10 in the Piraeus, and each of these had a jurisdiction about the agora, and whatever else it was necessary to regulate in the cities, while 30 of them were invested with supreme authority. Some of these happened to be my relatives and acquaintances, and they forthwith invited me to attend to state affairs as being a suitable pursuit. And how I was affected is, on account of my youth, not at all wonderful. For I thought that they would, by leading the city from an unjust mode of living to a just one, administer it in the way it was meet, so that I diligently gave my mind to what they did. But when I saw these men proving in a short time that the previous form of government had been, as it were, gold, and that they committed other acts unjustly, and sent my friend Socrates, advanced in years, whom I am not ashamed to say was nearly the most righteous man of those then living, together with certain others, against one of the citizens, and to bring him by force, in order that he might be executed, so that he, Socrates, might have a share in their deeds, whether he wished it or not, and that he did not comply, but ran the risk of suffering everything rather than take any part in their impious acts. All this, when I saw, and other similar acts of no trifling kind, I felt indignant, and withdrew myself from the evil men of that period. Not long after this, the power of the 30 fell by revolution, together with the whole of the then existing form of government. Again, therefore, but somewhat more slowly, did a desire still drag me on to engage in public and political affairs. Now in these, as being in a troubled state, many things took place at which any one might be indignant. Nor was it wonderful that in revolutions the punishment of hostile factions should have been rather severe in the case of some, although they who returned acted with considerable clemency. But by some chance, some of those in power brought before a court of justice our friend Socrates, laying upon him an accusation the most unholy, and belonging the least of all to Socrates. For some brought him to trial, and others gave their vote against him, and destroyed the man who had been unwilling to share in the unholy act of a removal relating to one of his then exiled friends, when the exiles themselves were unfortunate. On reflecting then upon these matters, and on the persons who managed political affairs, and on the laws and customs, the more I considered them, and I advanced in years, by so much the more difficulty did it appear to me to administer correctly state affairs. For it is not possible to do so without friends and faithful associates, whom, existing at that time, it was not easy to find. For our city was then no longer administered according to the manners and institutions of our fathers, and it was impossible to acquire new with any facility, while the written laws and customs were corrupted, and unholiness was increasing to a degree how wonderful! So that I, who had been at first full of ardor towards engaging in affairs of state, did, upon looking at these things, and seeing them carried along in every way, and on every side, become giddy, but not so as to withdraw from considering how at any time something better might take place respecting these very matters, and likewise the whole form of government, but to be wisely waiting continually for opportunities of acting. At last I perceived that all states existing at present were badly governed, for what relates to their laws is nearly in an incurable state, without some wonderful arrangement in conjunction with fortune. I was, therefore, compelled to say, in praise of true philosophy, that through it we are enabled to perceive all that is just as regards the state and individuals, and hence that the human race will never cease from ills until the race of those who philosophize correctly and truthfully shall come to political power, or persons of power in states shall, by a certain divine allotment, philosophize really. Holding these sentiments, I arrived in Italy and Sicily when I first came there, but on my arrival the life which is there called happy pleased me at no time or manner, a life full of the tables prepared by Italiates and Syracusians, and where one is filled twice a day, and never lies alone by night, and has such other pursuits as follow a life of this kind. For from these habits no man under heaven, having such pursuits from his youth, would ever become prudent, not even if he were mixed up with a wondrous nature by some god. But to become temperate it will never be his care. And the same thing may be said respecting the remaining portion of virtue. Nor will any state rest quietly according to any laws whatever, while men conceive that it is proper to waste everything on excesses, and deem that they ought to be idle in everything except good living and drinking, and the labored exertions made for sexual intercourse. But it is necessary for such states never to cease changing their tyrannies, oligarchies, and democracies, and for the powerful in them not to endure even the name of a polity, just and with equal laws. With these and the above-mentioned sentiments, I passed over to Syracuse, perhaps through an accident of fortune. At least it seems that by the planning of some superior being, a beginning was laid of the doings that have lately taken place relating to Dion, and of those two relating to Syracuse, and there is a fear to still more persons, if you do not yield to me when giving advice a second time. How then do I assert that my journey to Sicily was the beginning of all the then doings? For while associating with Dion, then a young man, and pointing out to him by words that what seemed good to me would be the best for mankind, and counseling him so to act, I was nearly ignorant that I was unconsciously planning in some manner the dissolution of a tyranny. For Dion, being very docile, both with respect to other things and the reasons urged by me, he heard so quickly and attentively as not one ever did of the young men whom I had fallen in with, and he was desirous of passing the remainder of his life in a manner superior to the majority of the Italiates and Siciliates, by loving virtue rather than pleasure and the rest of luxuries, and hence he lived rather odious to those who passed their lives according to tyrannical institutions until the death of Dionysius occurred. Subsequently, however, he perceived that the sentiments which he held under the influence of correct reasoning did not exist in him alone, but in some others, not numerous indeed, but amongst some, one of whom he thought would be probably Dionysius the Younger, if the gods assisted, and should this take place, that both his own life and that of the other Syracusans would turn out to be beyond all measure happy. He thought, moreover, that I ought by all means to come as quickly as possible to Syracuse, to take part in these doings, for he remembered how our mutual intercourse had easily worked him up to the desire of a life the most beautiful and best, which, if he could but accomplish, as he was attempting to do, in the case of Dionysius, he had great hopes that he could, without slaughter and death, and the evils which have now taken place, make, in the whole of the country, life to be happy and rational. With these correct sentiments, Dion persuaded Dionysius to send for me, and he himself requested me by all means to come as quickly as possible before certain other persons associating with Dionysius should turn him aside to a life different from the best. But it is necessary to relate what he requested, although it is a rather long story. What opportunity, said he, shall we wait for greater than that through a certain divine fortune? And giving a statement of their command over Italy and Sicily, and of his own power in it, and of the youth of Dionysius, and of the desire he felt so vehemently for philosophy and instruction, and saying how his cousins and kindred were to be easily exhorted to the reasoning and mode of life ever laid down by myself, and that they were most competent to exhort Dionysius, so that now, if ever, all the hope would be fulfilled of the same persons becoming philosophers and rulers of mighty states. Such, then, and many others of a like kind, were his exhortations. But a fear still possessed my mind as to how, perchance, the conduct of the young men would turn out. For the passions of such persons are hasty, and are often borne along in a direction contrary to themselves. I knew, however, that Dion was naturally of a steady disposition, and of a moderate age. Hence, while I was considering and doubting whether I ought to go, or how, the balance inclined that I ought to go. For if perchance any one should attempt to give effect to my ideas upon laws and a form of government, I ought to attempt it now. For, by persuading only one person, I should work out every good. With these ideas and confidence, and not from what some imagined, I set sail from home, feeling for myself the greatest shame, lest I should seem to myself to be altogether mere talk, and never willing to lay hold of anything to be done, and run the risk of betraying first the hospitality and friendship of Dion, exposed in reality to no small dangers, and should he suffer aught, or being driven out by Dionysius and his other enemies, fly to us, and, making an inquiry, say, I am come to you, Plato, an exile, but I am neither in want of cavalry, nor of heavy-armed soldiers to ward off my enemies, but of words and persuasion, by which I know you are especially able to turn young persons to what is good and just, and to place them on each occasion on terms of friendship and fellowship with each other, through the want of which, on your part, I have now left Syracuse, and am present here. What relates to myself, indeed, will bring upon you less disgrace, but the philosophy which you are always praising, and which you say is held in dishonor by the rest of mankind, how is it not now betrayed by you, together with myself, as far as depends upon you? If indeed we had been inhabitants of Megara, you would surely have come to me as an assistant for what I had called you, or I should have considered you the meanest of men. But now, excusing yourself by the length of the journey, and the danger of the voyage, and the greatness of the trouble, think you that you shall avoid perchance the charge of cowardice? It will be far from this. To language like this, what would have been a becoming answer? There is none. But I came with reason and justice as much as it is possible for a man, having left my own pursuits, which were not unbecoming, under a tyranny which was neither suited to my discourses nor myself. But by my coming I liberated myself from any charge, and exhibited myself to be unreproved by Zeus, who presides over hospitality and the allotment of philosophy, which would have been exposed to reproach had I acted an effeminate part, and through cowardice shared in disgrace and shame. On my arrival, then, for there is no need to be prolix, I found all the affairs of Dionysius full of sedition and calumnies on the part of a tyranny respecting Dion. I defended Dion, therefore, to the utmost of my power, but I was able to do but little. But nearly in the fourth month after my arrival, Dionysius accused Dion of plotting against his power, and putting him on board a small vessel, sent him out with dishonor, whereupon all of us, who were the friends of Dion, were fearful lest he should accuse and punish some one of us as an accomplice in the plot of Dion. And a report went abroad at Syracuse that I had been put to death by Dionysius, as being, forsooth, the cause of all that happened at that time. But on perceiving that we were all thus disposed, and dreading lest something of greater consequence should arise from our fear, he received all of us most kindly into his favor, consoled me, and exhorted me to be of good cheer, and requested me by all means to stay, for there would be an advantage to him from my not flying away, but for my remaining, and on this account he pretended to make an urgent request. We know, however, that the requests of tyrants are mingled with necessity. By a contrivance, therefore, he prevented my sailing away, for taking me to the Acropolis, he made me reside there, from whence no shipmaster could carry me off, not through Dionysius forbidding it merely, but unless Dionysius himself sent a person with an order, commanding him to lead me out. Nor was there any foreign trader, nor even one of those having jurisdiction over the departures from the country, who would have overlooked my going away alone, but he would immediately have laid hold of me and brought me back again to Dionysius, especially since it had been already bruited abroad, contrary to what had been done before, that Dionysius was again holding Plato to his arms in a wonderful manner. And indeed this was the case, for it is necessary to speak the truth. He did indeed hold me to his arms ever as time went on, more and more in respect to the intercourse of my manner and habits. But he wished me to praise him more than Dion, and to hold him as a friend in a far greater degree than the other, and for such an end he made wonderful efforts. But the way by which this might have taken place in the best manner, if it took place at all, he omitted, for he shrunk to become familiar and to associate with me by hearing and learning discourses on philosophy, through the fear lest, according to the language of calumniators, he should be shackled, and Dion administer all affairs. However, I endured everything, keeping to the original sentiments with which I arrived, if by any means he should come to the desire of a philosophic life. But he, by his pulling in a contrary direction, obtained the victory. In this way, then, happened to turn out the first period of my sojourning and pursuits in Sicily. After this, I went away, and came back again, through Dionysius having sent for me with all earnestness. but on what account I came, and what I did as being reasonable and just, I will, having first advised you what you ought to do, after what has just now taken place, subsequently relate in detail, for the sake of those who are inquiring with what view I came a second time to Sicily, and that deeds of no moment may not happen to be mentioned as deeds of moment. I say then something what I ought to say, for the party who gives advice to a sick man, and to one who uses a diet improper for good health, it is especially necessary in the first place to change the mode of living, and to recommend to the patient willing to comply the other things that are proper. But if he is unwilling, I consider that he, who retires from advising such a person, acts like a man and a physician, but that he who stays, like a person unmanly and devoid of art. The same is the case of a state, whether its master be one or many. If, while the government is proceeding in a right road according to the Constitution, it takes counsel about what is conducive to its interest, it is the part of a man with mind to give to such parties advice. But in the case of those who are proceeding entirely out of a straightforward polity, and not at all willing to walk in its steps, and who proclaim to the adviser to leave alone the form of government, and not to disturb it, since if he does disturb it, he shall suffer death, and at the same time exhort him to minister to their wishes and passions, and to advise in what way these may for all time to come be gratified, I should consider the person who endures to give such advice unmanly, but him who does not endure a man. Holding then such sentiments, whenever anyone consults with myself about anything of the greatest moment relating to his life, such as the acquisition of wealth, or the care of his body or soul, I readily advise with him, if he appears to me to live day by day in an orderly manner, or is willing to be persuaded by me when giving advice, nor do I desist, as if I have gone through merely a formal rite. But if either he does not consult me at all, or is evidently not about to follow my advice, I do not go self-called to such a person to counsel him, nor would I do so by compulsion, even if he were my son. But I would give advice to a slave, and force him, even unwilling, to follow it. I should, however, think it not holy to force my father or mother, unless they were, through disease, afflicted with silliness. But if persons are living an established mode of life, pleasing to themselves, but not to me, I should not, when admonishing them in vain, dislike them, nor yet by flattering, minister to them, and afford them the means of gratifying their desires, which, if I were to embrace, I should not wish to live. With the same sentiments respecting a state, a prudent man ought to live, and speak out if it appears to him not to have a good form of government, and if he is about not to speak in vain, nor to lose his life by speaking, but never to apply violence to his country on account of a change in the form of government, unless it cannot become the best without the banishment and slaughter of persons, but, leading a quiet life, to pray for the good, both of himself and of the state. In this very manner I would advise you to act, and so did I, together with Dion, advise Dionysius to live day by day, so that in the first place he might be about to become the master of himself, and acquire faithful friends and associates, in order that he might not suffer what his father did, who, after he had got possession of many and great cities in Sicily, which had been laid waste by the barbarians, was not able to establish and preserve in each of them forms of government faithful under his associates, or strangers coming from any part whatever, or brothers whom he himself had brought up as being younger, and had made them rulers after being merely private persons, and remarkably rich after being very poor. For among these he could not attach to himself a single one as the sharer of his dominion, although working upon them by persuasion, and teaching, and kindness, and alliances, and he was sevenfold worse off than Darius, who, placing a trust in persons, not his brothers, nor brought up by him, but in those alone associated with himself in their mastery over the eunuch, divided amongst them seven parts of his dominions, each larger than the whole of Sicily, and made use of them as faithful associates, and attacking neither himself nor each other, and gave likewise an example of what a lawgiver and a king ought to be. For he established laws by which he has preserved even now the Persian power, and besides this, the Athenians, although they had not colonized themselves many Grecian cities, which had been overturned by the barbarians, but merely got hold of them when already inhabited, preserved their empire over them for 70 years, through having persons friendly to them in each of the towns. But Dionysius, having through his wisdom brought together the whole of Sicily into one state, yet through confiding in no one, was with difficulty saved. For he was poor in persons friendly and faithful, than which there is no greater sign as regards virtue and vice than in being destitute, or not of men of that kind. I therefore, in Dion, advised Dionysius, since what he had received from his father had come to him unacquainted with instruction, and unacquainted too with befitting associates, in the first place to proceed in that direction to procure for himself friends different from his relations, but both his equals in age, and in accordance with him respecting virtue. But we particularly advised him to be in accord with himself, for that he was wonderfully deficient in this we asserted, not indeed in such clear terms, for this was not safe, but in hints and contending in our discourses, that in this way every man will preserve both himself and those over whom he is the ruler, but that by not turning himself in this direction, he will bring to pass everything the very reverse. But if, after going on, as we said, and rendering himself prudent and temperate, he peopled the cities of Sicily that had been made desolate, and bound them together with laws and forms of government, so as to be of one family with himself, and an assistance to each other against the barbarians, he would not only double his ancestral dominion, but make it in reality much larger. For if this were done, it would be much more easy to enslave the Carthaginians than was the slavery effected by them during the reign of Gelon. But not as now, on the contrary, his father fixed the tribute he was to carry to the barbarians. This is what was said, and the advice given to Dionysius by us, who were plotting against him, as the reports were circulated on many sides, such that after prevailing with Dionysius, they caused him to drive out Dion, and threw myself into a state of terror. But that I may bring to a close not a few events which occurred in a short time, Dion, departing from Peloponnesus and Athens, admonished Dionysius indeed. Since then Dion had liberated and twice restored the town to the citizens, the Syracusans were affected in the same manner towards him as Dionysius had been, when he endeavored, by educating and bringing him up, to make him thus a worthy partner of his power through the whole of life. But he gave his ear to those that were calumniating Dion, and saying that he was doing all that he did at that time, while plotting against the absolute power of Dionysius, in order that the one, being lulled in his mind by his attention to instruction, might neglect his kingdom and commit it to Dion, and the other make it his own by fraud, and cast out Dionysius from his dominions. These reports, being then bruited a second time among the Syracusans, prevailed by a victory very absurd and disgraceful to those who were the causes of it. For how it happened, it is proper for those to hear who are calling upon me on the subject of the present affairs. Being an Athenian, and the associate of Dion, and one who had battled with him against the tyrant, I arrived that I might produce a peace instead of a war, but while battling against the calumniators I was overcome. But Dionysius, attempting to bribe me by honors and riches, to become on his side a witness and a friend, touching the propriety of his casting out Dion, failed in all of these things happening to him, and Dion afterwards, on returning home from exile, brought with him two Athenian brothers, who had become his friends, not through philosophy, but through that acquaintance which runs through the generality of friends, and which they formed from paying the rites of hospitality, and from being muste and epopte. Moreover, these two, by having brought Dion back, had become his friends, and from such causes, and the assisting him in his return from exile, his companions. but when, on their arrival in Sicily, they understood that Dion had been exposed by those Siciliots who had become free through him to the calumny of plotting to become a tyrant, they not only betrayed their associate and guest, but became, as it were, the perpetrators of a murder, in that, with weapons in their hands, they stood by to assist the murderers. However, I neither pass by this base and unholy deed, nor do I detail it, for to many others it has been a care to him it, and it will be so at some future time. But the charge which has been alleged respecting the Athenians, how that it was they who bound this disgrace around the city, I will take away. For I say that he too was an Athenian who did not betray this very person when it was in his power to obtain wealth and many other honors. For he did not become a friend through a shopmate friendship, but through the communion of a liberal education, to which alone he who is endued with mind ought to trust, rather than to the alliance of souls and bodies, so that those too were not fit to bring disgrace on the city through having murdered Dion, as being persons of no account at any time. All this has been said for the sake of the advice given to the friends and kindred of Dion. I give you besides the same counsel, and for the third time address you three in the same words. Do not place Sicily, or any other city, as a slave under persons with despotic power, but under laws. Such at least is my dictum, for this is not the better either for the enslaving or the enslaved, or for their children or their children's descendants, but the experiment is altogether a destructive one. For souls whose habits are little and illiberal love to seize upon gain of this kind, as knowing nothing of what is good and just for the future and present time, nor of things human and divine. Of this I endeavored to persuade Dion first, and secondly Dionysius, and now I do you the third. Be persuaded then by me, for the sake of Zeus, the third Savior. In the next place, look to the case of Dionysius and Dion, the former of whom, by not being persuaded, is now living not honorably, whereas the latter, by being persuaded, died honorably. For it is a thing altogether correct and honorable for him who aspires after things the most honorable, both for himself and his country, to suffer whatever he may suffer. For not one of us is naturally immortal, nor, if this should happen to any one, would he become happy, as it seems he would to the multitude. For in things inanimate there is nothing either good or evil worthy of mention, but good or ill will happen to each soul, either existing with the body or separated from it. But it is ever requisite to trust really to the sacred accounts of the olden time, which inform us that the soul is immortal, and has judges of its conduct, and suffers the greatest punishments when it is liberated from the body. Hence it is requisite to think it is a lesser evil to suffer than to do the greatest sins and injuries. This indeed the man who is fond of money and poor in soul does not hear, and should he hear, he laughs it down, as he imagines, and impudently snatches from all sides whatever he thinks he can, like a wild beast, eat or drink, or can contribute aught to the miscalled pleasure of sexual intercourse, at once servile and graceless. For, being blind, he is not able to see how great an evil, ever united to each act of wrong, follows the never being satisfied with the unholy perpetration of such snatchings, which it is necessary for him who has acted unjustly to drag along with himself, both while he is moving about upon the earth, and when he takes under the earth a journey without honor, and thoroughly miserable in every way. By detailing these and other reasons of the like kind, I was enabled to persuade Dion, and I should have felt most justly against those who murdered him an anger, in a certain manner, almost as great as against Dionysius, for both had injured myself, and all the rest, so to say, in the highest degree, for the former had destroyed a man who was willing to make use of justice, while the latter was unwilling to make use of it through the whole of his dominions, although possessing the greatest power, in which dominions, had philosophy and power existed really, as it were in the same dwelling, they would have set up amongst all men, both Greeks and barbarians an opinion not vainly shining, and in every respect the true one, that neither a state nor a man can ever be happy unless by leading a life with prudence in subjection to justice, whether possessing those things themselves, or by being brought up in the habits of holy persons their rulers, or instructed in justice. This injury did Dionysius inflict, but the rest would have been a trifling wrong as compared to these. But he who murdered Dion did not know that he had done the same deed as Dionysius, for I clearly know, as far as it is possible for one man to speak confidently of another, that if Dion had retained his power, he would never have changed it to any other form of government than to that by which he first caused Syracuse, his own country, after he had delivered it from slavery, to look joyous, and had put it into the garb of freedom. And after this, he would by every contrivance have adorned the citizens with laws both befitting and the best, and he would have been ready to do what followed in due order after this, and have colonized the whole of Sicily, and have freed it from the barbarians, by expelling some and subduing others, more easily than Hiero did. But if these things had taken place through a man just and brave and temperate, and who was a philosopher, the same opinion of virtue would have been produced amongst the multitude, as would have been amongst all men, so to say, and have saved Dionysius, had he been persuaded by me. But now, some daimon, surely, or some evil spirit, falling upon with iniquity and impiety, and, what is the greatest matter, with the audacity of ignorance in which all evils are rooted, and from which they spring up, and afterwards produce fruit the most bitter to those who have begotten it, this has a second time subverted and destroyed everything. However, let us, for the sake of a good augury, keep for the third time a well-omened silence. I advise, therefore, you, my friends, to imitate Dion in the goodwill he felt for his country, and in his temperate mode of living, but for the better. But under what auspices you ought to endeavor to fulfill his wishes, and what they are, you have clearly heard from me. But upon the person who is among you unable to live according to his country's customs in a Dorian fashion, but adopts the life of the murderers of Dion, and what is followed in Sicily, do not call nor believe that he will in anything ever act faithfully and sincerely. But call upon the rest to form a settlement of the whole of Sicily, and introduce both from Sicily itself and all Peloponnesus an equality of laws. And do not fear the Athenians, for men are there who surpass all others in virtue, and who hate the daring of guest murderers. But if these things be done at a later period, and the differences produced each day by factions are many and of all kinds, and hasten you on, it is requisite surely for every man to whom a divine fortune has imparted even a small degree of correct thinking to know that there will be no cessation of evils to those engaged in revolts until the victors in battle and in the banishment and slaughter of persons shall cease to have a recollection of wrongs and to turn themselves to the punishment of their opponents, but having a mastery over themselves shall lay down laws common to all and no less acceptable to themselves than to the vanquished party, and compel them to use these laws by the twofold necessity of fear and shame, of fear through their being superior by showing their strength, and of shame, on the other hand, through their seeming to be superior in the being both willing and able to be the masters over pleasures, and the slaves of the laws. For it is not possible otherwise for a state divided against itself to cease from ills, but divisions and enmity and hatred and distrust are ever wont to arise in states thus arrayed themselves against themselves. It is then ever requisite for those who have gained the power, when they are desirous of preserving it, to choose from amongst themselves, in preference to the rest, such as they hear are the best. In the first place, old men who have children and wives at home, and ancestors the most in number and renown, and all possessing a competence. Now, for a city of 10,000 persons, 50 such will be sufficient. These should be sent for from their home with prayers and the greatest honors possible, and they who have sent for them should take an oath and beg and request them to lay down laws and give not more to the victors than to the vanquished, but what is equal for and common to the whole state. And when the laws have been fixed, all things are in this. For when the victors exhibit themselves more subject to the laws than the vanquished, all things will be full of security and felicity, and there will be an escape from every ill. But if not, call not upon me or any other to take a part for him who is not persuaded by the precepts now conveyed. For these are the sisters of what I and Dion did with good intentions attempt to do for Syracuse, although they were, on the second occasion, for the first were those which were first attempted to be done, in conjunction with Dionysius, a common good to all, but a certain fortune superior to man scattered them all. Do you then attempt to accomplish all at present more prosperously with the aid of some kind of destiny and a luck God sent? And thus much be it said about my advice and letter and first visit to Dionysius. But in my second journey and voyage to Sicily, how reasonably and carefully they took place, he who feels any interest may hear what followed. For the first period of my sojourn in Sicily passed away, as I have stated, before I could advise the relatives and associates of Dion. But subsequently I persuaded Dionysius as far as I was able to let me go. But on peace being made, for there had been then a war in Sicily, we both came to an agreement. For Dionysius said that he would send for Dion and myself again after he had established for himself a state of affairs connected with his government more securely than before, and he thought it proper for Dion to understand that this was not a banishment at that time, but merely a change of residence, and on these conditions I agreed to come. On peace being made, Dionysius sent for me, but he requested Dion to stop another year, but he thought it proper for myself to come by all means. Dion then exhorted and entreated me to set sail, for a strong report had gone abroad from Sicily that Dionysius had become again wonderfully eager after philosophy at that moment, and on this account Dion earnestly begged of me not to decline the invitation. But I knew that many such things happen to young men in the case of philosophy. However, it seemed to me to be more safe, at least at that time, to bid a long farewell to Dionysius and Dion, and I gave offense to both by answering that I was an old man, and that nothing of what was now being done had taken place according to the agreement. But after this it seems that Archytas had betaken himself to Dionysius. Now, before my departure, having made a hospitable and friendly acquaintance with Archytas and certain other Tarentines, the guests and friends of Dionysius, I sailed away. There were, likewise, certain other persons at Syracuse who had heard some of the doctrines of Dion, and among these some others filled with wrong notions about philosophy, and who seemed to me to attempt to discourse with Dionysius about things of this kind, as if Dionysius had heard all such matters as I had in my thoughts. But in other respects he was not without natural talent or the power to learn, and had a love of honor in a wonderful degree. Perhaps, then, the discourse of these men was pleasing to him, and he was manifestly ashamed that he heard nothing from me when I was sojourning there. Hence he came the same time to the longing to hear me more clearly, and at the same time his love of honor urged him on. But on what account he did not hear me during my first sojourn I have detailed in the account given above. After I had returned home safe, and refused on his inviting me a second time, as I have just now mentioned, Dionysius appeared to be thoroughly on fire through his love of honor, lest I should seem to some persons to hold him in contempt, and that, as being acquainted with his nature and habits and mode of living, I was unwilling to be annoyed by going to him. But I am justified in speaking the truth, and in enduring, if anyone, on hearing what had occurred, should despise my philosophy, and think that the tyrant possessed a mind. For Dionysius sent to me the third time a trireme for the sake of making easy the voyage. He sent also Archidemus, whom he thought I valued the most of all the associates of Archytas, who were then in Sicily, and others of his own acquaintances, and all these told to us the same story, that Dionysius had wonderfully increased in philosophy. He sent, too, a long letter, well knowing how I was affected towards Dion, and that Dion was desirous I should set sail and come to Syracuse. With a view to all these particulars, therefore, the letter was composed, and at the commencement it said somehow to this effect. Dionysius to Plato. After saying what usually follows, he said nothing previous to this except that, should you, at my persuasion, come now to Sicily, in the first place the matters relating to Dion shall be put into a train in the way you may wish yourself, for I know that you wish what is moderate, and I will accede to them. Otherwise nothing that relates to the affairs of Dion, nor upon other points, nor as regards himself, will take place. This is what he said, but the rest that was said would be here prolix and foreign to the purpose. Other letters likewise came to me from Archytas and others at Tarentum, speaking in high terms of the love of wisdom shown by Dionysius, and that unless I came now, I should bring into a state of calumny the friendship existing with Dionysius, which had been affected through me, and which was of no little moment to their political affairs. Such, then, being the state at that time of the sending for me, some of those from Sicily and Italy dragging me thither, and others at Athens pushing me away plainly by their entreaties, the same reason returned, that I ought not to betray Dion, nor my guests and friends at Tarentum, and it occurred to me that it was nothing wonderful that a young man who had heard incorrectly of things worthy of mention should come with a docile spirit to the love of the best life, and that I ought to prove clearly in what state the matter stood, and not by any means to betray it, nor to become myself the cause of a disgrace so truly great, if the case was in reality such as reported. Clothing myself then in this reasoning, I departed, fearing much, and prophesying, as it seems, not altogether well. Arriving then the third time, for the Saviour this at least I did in reality, for I was again luckily saved, and for this it is meet for me to give thanks to Dionysius, after the deity, because, when many were wishing to destroy me, he prevented them, and gave up to pity some portion of my affairs. When, therefore, I arrived, I thought I ought first to obtain some proof whether Dionysius was in reality touched by philosophy, as by a fire, or whether this great report had come to Athens in vain. Now, there is a certain method of making an experiment upon matters of this kind, by no means ignoble, but truly adapted to tyrants, and especially to such as are full of incorrect notions, which, as soon as I arrived, I perceived was very much the case with Dionysius. To such it is requisite to show what philosophy is, and of what kind, and through how great deeds, how great a labor it demands. For he who hears this, if he is truly a lover of wisdom, and related to it, and worthy of it, as being a divine person, thinks he has heard of some wonderful road, and that he ought forthwith to betake himself to it, and that life is not to be endured by him who acts otherwise. After this, he does not, putting both himself and his leader on the stretch, give up the road until he puts a finish upon all things, or obtains a power so as not to be unable to conduct himself without a person to show the road. In this way, and with these thoughts, does such a person live, acting correctly, in whatever transactions he may be engaged, but before all things perpetually keeping close to philosophy, and making use of that food for the day, which may especially render him quick to learn, and of a good memory, and able to reason in himself, by abstaining from wine, and by which he becomes the hater of a practice contrary to this. But they who are not lovers of wisdom in reality, but have a coating of color in their opinions, like those whose bodies are sunburnt, when they perceive how many things are to be learnt, and how great is the labor, and what temperance in daily food is requisite for that thing, they deem it too difficult and beyond their powers, and become unable to attend to it at all. But some of them persuade themselves that they have sufficiently heard the whole, and want no further exertions. This kind of experiment is clear, and the most safe, when employed in the case of those living luxuriously, and unable to endure labor, through the person throwing the blame not upon the guide, but on himself, as being unable to attend to all that is requisite for the matter in hand. In this way was what has been now stated mentioned to Dionysius, but neither did I detail them all, nor did Dionysius require it, for many things, and of the greatest moment, he pretended to possess sufficiently himself through the incorrect notions he had heard from others, and I hear that he afterwards wrote about what he had then heard, as if he were composing what was his own art, when there was nothing of his own, as I hear. However, of this I know nothing, but I know that certain others have written about the same things, but who they are, not they themselves. Thus much, however, I can say about all who either have written or shall write, and state that they know about what things I am occupied, whether they have heard from myself or others, or have discovered themselves, that it is not possible for them to know anything according to my opinions upon the matter, for there is not, and never will be, any composition of mine about them, for a matter of that kind cannot be expressed by words, like other things to be learnt, but by a long intercourse with the subject, and living with it, a light is kindled on a sudden, as if from a leaping fire, and, being engendered in the soul, feeds itself upon itself. Thus much I know, however, that what has been written or said by me has been said in the best manner, and moreover, that what has been written badly does not pain me in the least. But if it had appeared to me that such matters could be written or spoken of sufficiently before the masses, what could have been done by us more beautiful in life than to impart a great benefit to mankind, and to bring nature to light before all? I think, however, that the attempt in favor of such being promulgated would not be beneficial except to a few who are able with a little showing to make discoveries for themselves. But of the rest, some it will fill not correctly with a contempt by no means in reason, and others with a lofty and vain hope, as if they had learnt something solemn. And it has now come into my mind to say something further still. For perhaps, by what I am about to say, a portion of what has been said will become more clear. For a certain true account is the antagonist of him who dares to write anything whatever about matters of this kind, and which, although it has been stated by me frequently before, seems it must be stated at present likewise. There are three things belonging to each of those through which it is necessary for science to be produced, but the fourth is science itself. And, as to the fifth, it is requisite to establish that which is known and true. Of these, one is its name, the second its definition, the third its resemblance, the fourth its science. Now, if you are desirous of understanding what has been just now asserted respecting one example, take it and imagine thus respecting all. A circle is called something to which there is the name we have just mentioned. Its definition is the second thing, composed of nouns and verbs. For that, which is everywhere equally distant from the extremes to the middle, would be the definition of that to which the name is of a round, and a circumference, and a circle. But the third is the circle, painted or blotted out, and made by a turner's wheel, or destroyed. By none of which accidents is the circle itself, of which all these properties are predicated, affected as being of a different nature. But the fourth is science and intellect, and a correct opinion about them. And the whole of this again must be laid down as one thing, which exists neither in voice, nor in a corporeal figure, but is in the soul, by which circumstance it is manifest that there is something different from the nature itself of the circle and the three previously mentioned. but among the number of these, intellect, by its relation and similitude, approaches the nearest to the fifth, while the rest are more remote. The same is the case with respect to a thing straight and circular, and with figure, and with color, and of a thing good, and beautiful, and just, and of every body, both fashioned by the hand, and produced according to nature, and of fire, and water, and all things of that kind, and of every animal, and of the habit in souls, and of all actions and passions. For unless a person does, after a certain manner, understand of these things all the four, he will never perfectly participate in the science relating to the fifth. Moreover, these four no less endeavor to show forth the quality as respects each thing than the being of each through the want of power in words. On this account, no one possessing a mind will ever dare to place under the same view, and this too, never to be changed, the objects which are perceived by the mind, and those that are represented by figures, which is the case with those four. And this again, what has just now been said, it is requisite to learn. Every circle described by its doings, or fashioned by a turner's wheel, is full of that which is contrary to the fifth, for it everywhere touches upon the straight line. But we assert that the circle in the abstract has neither more nor less in itself of a contrary nature. And we assert, too, that there is no fixed name for anything, for there is nothing to prevent things that are now called round from being called straight, and those straight, round, nor will there be any less stability in them when they are changed and called by a contrary name. The same assertion is likewise true of a definition, that since it is composed of nouns and verbs, there is nothing stable in a sufficiently stable manner, and there is an infinity of reasons respecting each of the four, that it is uncertain. But what is of the greatest moment is, that since there are, as I have stated a little before, two things, being and quality, when the soul seeks to know not the quality of a thing, but what it is, unless each of these four previously sought for by the soul through reason and effect, and at last turns out correctly discussed by the senses, through all things that are said and shown, it fills every man, so to say, with all doubt and uncertainty. In such cases, then, as through a depraved education we are not accustomed to seek the truth, but the image of it, which is placed before us, is sufficient for us to touch upon. We do not become ridiculous to each other, the interrogated to the interrogating, but we are able to bandy about those four, and to examine them. But in such cases, as we compel a person to exhibit that fifth, any one of those who are able to reply, and to overthrow, is the superior, and causes him who is explaining this fifth, either by speech, or writing, or answers, to appear to the multitude of his hearers entirely ignorant of the things about which he attempts either to write or speak, persons being sometimes ignorant that it is not the soul of the writer or speaker that is confuted, but the nature of each of the four spoken of when it is existing improperly. But the procession through all these, while changing its place towards each upwards and downwards, scarcely at length generates the knowledge of a thing existing naturally well in a person existing naturally well. But when it exists naturally ill, as exists naturally the habit of the soul of the multitude with respect to learning and to what are called morals, and these are depraved, not even Lincius himself can cause such as these to see. And in one word, neither docility in learning nor memory will cause a person to do so who is not germane to the matter, for they are not originally inherent in foreign habits, so that neither they, who are not naturally close to and allied with what is just, and the other things that are beautiful, but are docile and of a good memory, some with respect to some things, and others to others, nor they, who are allied, but are indocile and of a bad memory, will ever learn, as far as is possible, the truth relating to virtue and vice. For it is necessary to learn these, and at the same time the falsehood and truth of the whole of being, with all exertion and much time, as I stated at the commencement. But after each of these have been rubbed together, names and definitions, and the sense of seeing, and the other senses, and have been tried by tests in a kindly spirit, and by questions and answers without a feeling of envy, there has with difficulty shone forth an intellectual perception respecting each, and a mind putting itself on the stretch, as far as it is possible for human power to do so. On this account, let every careful man be very far from writing about things truly worthy of care, lest at some time, by writing amongst men, he throw himself into envy and difficulties. But, in one word, it is requisite to know from hence, when anyone sees the writings of another, either of a legislator upon laws, or of any person whatever upon other subjects, that these are not those on which he has been the most careful, if he is himself a careful person, but that the objects of his pursuit are situated somewhere in a country the most beautiful. But if the subjects on which he has been the most careful are committed to writing, then not the gods, but men themselves, have their own intellect destroyed. Now he who follows this story in digression will understand correctly whether Dionysius has written anything of the highest and first kind respecting nature, or any other person inferior or superior to him, since, according to my reasoning, he has neither heard or learnt anything sound about what he has written, for he would have venerated them equally with myself, nor have dared to cast them forth into a state unfitting and unbecoming, nor has he written about them for the sake of remembering them, since there is no fear that anyone will ever forget them if he has once comprehended them by the soul, for of all things they lie in the smallest compass. But perhaps he did so for the sake of base ambition, considering them as his own, or as sharing in a kind of instruction of which he was unworthy, and loving the renown arising from such a participation. If, however, this occurred to Dionysius after one meeting, the fact may be so. But let Zeus, says the Theban, know how it occurred. For I went through these matters, as I have said, only once, and never afterwards at all. In the next place, he who is interested in discovering what occurred relating to those matters, and how it occurred, ought to consider through what reason it was we did not go through them a second and a third time and oftener. Whether it was that Dionysius, having heard them only once, thought he knew them and did know them sufficiently, or that he discovered them himself, or had learnt them previously from others, or that what had been said was trifling, or, thirdly, that they were not according to his standard, but greater, and that thus he would not be able to live if he paid any regard to prudence and virtue. For if it be said that he considered the matters frivolous, he will oppose many witnesses who assert the contrary, and who are much more competent to judge about things of this kind than Dionysius. But if that he discovered or learnt them, and that they are worthily suited for the instruction of a liberal soul, how should he, not being a wondrous man himself, have so readily dishonored the leader and the Lord in these matters? And how he did dishonor them, I will relate. After an interval of no long time, although he had previously permitted Dion to possess and enjoy his property, he did not permit his guardians to send it to Peloponnesus, as if he had entirely forgotten his letter. For he said it was not Dion, but Dion's son, of whom, as being his own nephew, he was, according to law, the guardian. Such were the transactions of that time that took place up to this period. And from these occurrences I clearly saw the desire Dionysius had for philosophy, and it was lawful for me to be indignant, whether I wished it or not, for it was already summer at that time, and ships were sailing out. But it seemed I ought not to be more offended with Dionysius than with myself, and with those who compelled me to come the third time to the strait about Scylla, and dread Charybdis measure still again, and to tell Dionysius that it was impossible for me to stay with him while Dion was treated so dirtily. But he soothed me and begged me to stay, thinking it would not be well for him should I be so swift a messenger of such doings. But, unable to persuade me, he said he would prepare the means of sending me away. However, I determined to go on board and sail amongst the vessels outward bound, being enraged, and thinking I ought to suffer everything if he should attempt to stop me, as I had been injured, although I had plainly done no injury. But on seeing that I had no desire at all to stay, he devised a plan of this kind for delaying my sailing away. On the day after this had taken place, he plausibly addresses me, "From myself and you," said he, "let Dion and the affairs of Dion be removed out of the way for the sake of our not being frequently at variance about them. For I will," said he, "thus act on your account to Dion. I think it right for him to take away his property and to reside in Peloponnesus, not as an exile, but as one who may come hither when it shall seem good to him, to me, and to you who are his friends. And this shall be, if he forms no plot against myself, and you, and your relations, and his here, shall be his sureties. And let him give you a guarantee, and let the property which he takes away be deposited in Peloponnesus and at Athens, with those you shall think fit. And let Dion enjoy the use of it, but not the power to take it away without your consent, for I have not any very great trust in him, that if he can use the property, he will be just towards myself, for it will not be trifling, but I have greater confidence in you and yours. See, therefore, if this is agreeable to you, and remain on these terms for this year, and then depart to your well-doing, taking with you the property, and well I know that Dion will be greatly indebted to you for having managed matters in this way on his behalf." On hearing this speech, I felt indignant, but still I said I would take counsel of myself until the following day on these points, and communicate my resolves. This was our compact at that time. I, hereupon, being all alone and very confused, took counsel of myself, and this consideration first presented itself as taking the lead in my designs. What if Dionysius intends to do nothing that he says, but on my departure, both he and many others of his friends should write in a plausible manner to Dion what he has now said to me, that Dionysius indeed was willing, but I unwilling, for him to do what he urged me, and that I entirely neglected his, Dion's, concerns. And, moreover, should Dionysius be unwilling to send me away, and himself give no orders to any master of a vessel to take me, and easily signify to all men that I was sailing away without his consent, what sailor would be willing to take me on board while I was hastening from the dwelling of Dionysius? For in addition to other evils, I dwelt in the garden which surrounds the dwelling, from whence the porter would not be willing to let me out unless an order were sent from Dionysius. And should I remain a year, I could indeed send an account of these doings to Dion, and in what state I was, and what I was doing. But should Dionysius do aught of what he says, my conduct would be not entirely ridiculous. For perhaps the property of Dion, if one rightly values it, is not less than 100 talents. But if what is now looming should, as is likely, take place, I shall be at a loss how to conduct myself. At the same time, it is perhaps necessary for me to labor for a year longer, and to endeavor to prove the designs of Dionysius by his deeds. Having thus determined with myself, I told Dionysius on the following day that I had made up my mind to stay. "I hold it right, however," said I, "for you not to consider me as the master of Dion, and that you should, together with myself, send letters to inform him of the determination, and to ask him whether he was satisfied, and if not, whether he wished for and demanded anything else, and to send word as soon as possible, but that you should do nothing new in his affairs." This was said by me, and this agreement did we make nearly in the manner just now detailed. After this the vessel sailed, and it was no longer possible for me to depart, when Dionysius, while speaking, remembered that the half of Dion's property ought to remain with his son, and that the other half should be sent to Dion, and he said he would sell it, and, after it had been sold, deliver one half to myself to send to Dion, and leave the other half for his son, for that this would be the most equitable arrangement. Astonished at the statement, I thought it would be very ridiculous to say anything further. I told him, however, that we ought to wait for the letter from Dion, and again send him an account of these matters. But Dionysius immediately after this did, in a very bold manner, sell the whole of Dion's property, at what time, and in what manner, and to whomsoever he pleased. Nor did he say anything whatever about it to myself, and in like manner I said nothing to him about the affairs of Dion, for I thought I should be able to do nothing more in the matter. Thus far was assistance given by myself to philosophy and my friends. But after this, I and Dionysius were so living that I, like a bird, was always looking out and longing to fly away, while he was devising in what manner he might frighten me off, and give up none of the property of Dion. We gave out, however, through the whole of Sicily that we were friends forsooth. Dionysius had attempted to reduce the pay of the veteran mercenaries now to a lower rate than according to the custom of his father, and the soldiers, being enraged, collected together in a body, and declared they would not permit it. Dionysius therefore endeavored to force them by closing the gates of the Acropolis, but the soldiers immediately rushed to the walls, raising a kind of barbarous cry and warlike paean, at which Dionysius, being terrified, conceded all demands, and even more to those of the light shield bearers who had been collected together. But a report was quickly spread that Heraclides was the cause of this disturbance, on hearing which Heraclides took himself out of the way and disappeared, while Dionysius endeavored to lay hold of him. But being in a difficulty, he sent for Theodotus to come to the garden in which I happened to be then walking. Now, of the rest of their discourse, I neither knew nor heard, but what Theodotus said in my presence to Dionysius, I both know and remember. For, said he, Plato, I am persuading Dionysius here, that if I am able to bring Heraclides hither to a conference respecting the charges now laid against him, and if it does not seem good to Dionysius for him to dwell in Sicily, I think it is proper for him to take his wife and son and sail to Peloponnesus and reside there, doing no injury at all to Dionysius and enjoying his own property. I have, therefore, sent to him already, and I will now send to him again. But whether he hearkens to my first or second application, I deem it right to request of Dionysius that if anyone falls in with Heraclides, either in the country or here, no ill shall happen to him, but that he shall be removed from the country until Dionysius shall decide upon something else. To this, said he, do you accede? Addressing Dionysius, he answered, I do accede, nor shall he suffer any ill contrary to what has now been stated, should he make his appearance at your house. However, on the evening of the following day, Eurubius and Theodotus came to me in great haste and wonderfully alarmed, and Theodotus said to me, Plato, you were present yesterday at the compact which Dionysius made with me and you respecting Heraclides? To which I replied, How not? But now, says he, the soldiers with light shields are running all round, seeking to lay hold of Heraclides, and it appears almost that he is somewhere here. Follow us, then, by all means to Dionysius. We went, therefore, and came to him, and they indeed stood silent and in tears. But I said, These persons, Dionysius, are afraid lest you should do something of a novel kind to Heraclides, contrary to the compact made yesterday. For it seems to me that he has returned, and is clearly somewhere here. And he, on hearing this, burnt with rage, and assumed all kinds of colors, such as a person in anger does. But Theodotus, falling at his feet, and laying hold of his hand, burst into tears, and implored him not to do any such thing. Then I, taking up the discourse, consoled him and said, Cheer up, Theodotus, for Dionysius will not dare to act contrary to the compact made yesterday. But he, looking at me, and in a very tyrannic manner, With you, says he, I made no compact, either great or small. By the gods, said I, you did agree not to do what this man now requests you not to do. After saying this, I turned from him and went out. After this, Dionysius endeavored to hunt down Heraclides. Theodotus, however, sent messengers to him and exhorted him to fly. But Dionysius sent Tisias and the soldiers with light shields and ordered them to pursue him. Heraclides, however, as it is said, anticipated them and escaped in the small part of a day into the dominions of the Carthaginians. Hereupon, the old plot for his not giving up the property of Dion seemed to Dionysius to offer a plausible pretext of enmity against myself, and in the first place he sent me from the Acropolis, framing an excuse that it was requisite for the women to perform some 10-day sacrifice in the gardens where I resided. He therefore ordered me to remain out during that period with Archidemus. While I was there, Theodotus sent for me, and felt very indignant respecting the transactions of that time, and found fault with Dionysius, who, hearing that I had been with Theodotus, made this another pretext, and the sister to the former, for enmity against me, and sent a person to ask me whether I had really been with Theodotus on his sending for me, and I readily replied I had. The party therefore said, "Dionysius has ordered me to tell you that you are acting by no means correctly in always making much of Dion and the friends of Dion." This is what was said, and after this Dionysius never again sent for me to his residence, as it was now clear that I was the friend of Theodotus and Heraclides and his enemy, and he no longer considered me well affected towards him, because the property of Dion had been consumed entirely. After this I dwelt out of the Acropolis among the mercenary soldiers, but others, Athenians, and some likewise my fellow citizens, who were in the service of Dionysius, came and told me that I had been calumniated by the light shield soldiers, and that certain persons had threatened to kill me if they could lay hold of me. I devised, therefore, the following plan for my preservation. I sent to Archytas and other friends at Tarentum, telling them in what state I happened to be, and they, making some pretext of an embassy to the city, sent a ship of 30 oars, and Lamascus, one of my friends, who, on his arrival, made a request to Dionysius on my behalf, saying that I wished to depart, and begged of him not to act otherwise. And he consented, and sent me away after providing me with means for the voyage. However, I neither asked for the property of Dion, nor did anyone give it me. On reaching Peloponnesus at the Olympic Games, I met with Dion, who was a spectator there, and I told him what had happened, and he, calling Jupiter to witness, immediately declared to me, and my relations and friends, that he would prepare to revenge himself upon Dionysius, both for his having deceived me, his guest, for thus he spoke and thought, and for his own unjust expulsion and banishment. On hearing this, I advised him to call upon his friends, if they were willing, but as for myself, I said, "You, together with others, had by force caused me in some manner to share in the food, and the hearth, and the sacred rites of Dionysius, who perhaps has thought, in consequence of many calumniating me, that I was plotting in conjunction with you against him and his tyranny, and yet he did not put me to death, but treated me with respect. Besides, I am of an age to take a part with scarcely anyone in war, but I would be a common friend to you all, if at any time in want of a friendly feeling towards each other you should wish to do any good. But if you are desirous of doing evil, call upon others." This did I say through a feeling of disgust to my wandering about Sicily and adverse fortune in it. By not obeying and being not persuaded by the reasonings urged by myself, they have been themselves the cause of all the evils that have at present happened to them, of which nothing, humanly speaking, would have occurred had Dionysius given Dion his own property, or had been perfectly reconciled to him. For I could easily have restrained Dion from both by my will and power. But now they have rushed against each other, and filled all things with evils. And yet Dion had the same wish, which I would say both myself and any other moderate person ought to have, who should consider, touching his own power, and that of his friends, and of his own city, how, by doing a benefit when in power, things of the greatest moment would be in the greatest honor. But this will be, not if a person enrich himself and his friends and city by laying plots and bringing together conspirators, when he is poor and has no command over himself through his yielding to cowardice, as regards pleasures, and subsequently by destroying those who possess property and calling them enemies, scatters the wealth of such persons, and exhorts his fellow doers and friends so to act, that no one shall, by saying that he is poor, bring a charge against him. After the same manner, he who benefits his city will be honored by it in consequence of distributing by voting the property of a few among the many, or when any one being the president of a great city, and one ruling over many lesser cities, unjustly distributes to his own city the property of the lesser. For in this way, neither Dion nor any other person will ever voluntarily proceed to power, pernicious to himself and family for all time, but to a form of government and the establishment of laws, the most just and best, and effected through the fewest deaths and banishments. This conduct did Dion lately adopt by choosing to suffer rather than to do unholy deeds, yet taking care lest he should suffer. Still, however, did he stumble after he had arrived at the very point of being superior to his foes. Nor did he suffer anything to be wondered at, for a man holy, temperate, and prudent will never be deceived entirely respecting unholy things, respecting the soul of such. But it would perhaps be not wonderful should he suffer the suffering of a good pilot, from whom a storm about to be has not entirely lain hid, but from whom the violence unusually great and unexpected of tempests may have lain hid, and, having lain hid, have by their force overwhelmed him. The same thing, upon a small scale, caused Dion to stumble, for they who tripped him up did not lie hid from him, as being wicked men, but what a depth of ignorance, and of the rest of depravity, and of greediness insatiable they possessed, this did lie hid, and stumbling on this point he lies dead, and Sicily wraps in sorrow infinite. What therefore I advise you to do, after the facts just now detailed, has been nearly told, and let them be told. But it appeared to me necessary to show why I undertook the second journey to Sicily, and, as it were, of somewhat a compulsory kind, on account of the absurdity and irrationality attached to the transactions. If, then, what has been now said has appeared to anyone to be more reasonable, and it seems to anyone that the excuses for what have occurred are sufficient, what has been now said will have been said moderately and sufficiently well. Epistle 8. Plato to the Relations and Friends of Dion. Prosperity. By considering what matters correctly you will do well in reality, I will endeavor, according to my power, to go through in detail, and I hope I shall advise what is conducive, not to you alone, especially at least, however, to you, and secondly, to all those at Syracuse, and thirdly, to your foes at home, and enemies abroad, unless some one of them shall have been guilty of an unholy act. For these things are incurable, nor can any one ever wash them out. But bear in mind what I now say. The tyranny having been dissolved through the whole of Sicily, there is now with you an universal strife about these very things, some wishing to resume the former government, but others to put the finish to the escape from tyranny. Now the council relating to such matters appears on each occasion to the multitude to be right, that it is requisite to advise what will affect the greatest evils to foes, and the greatest good to friends. It is, however, by no means easy for him who inflicts many evils on others not to suffer many himself. Nor is it necessary to go far to see this clearly, but what has taken place here and there relating to Sicily would suffice. While some are attempting to do, and others to ward off the doers, and by relating them as a tale to others, ye would become on each occasion competent instructors. In these matters, then, there is scarcely any difficulty. But what would be conducive to all, both foes and friends, or the least of an evil to both, this it is neither easy to see, nor for a person seeing to accomplish. The consultation of such a kind, and the attempt to speak, look like a prayer. Let it, then, be in every respect a prayer, for it is meet to begin from the gods in everything, both in speaking and thinking, and may it eventually indicate to us some such discourse as this. From the time that the war began, nearly one family has been ruling over both you and your enemies, whom your fathers established firmly when they came into all kinds of difficulty at the period when there was to that part of Sicily under Greeks a danger extreme of their becoming barbarians through their being entirely overthrown by the Carthaginians. At that time they chose Dionysius as being a person young and warlike, for the affairs of war suited him, but Hipparinus, his superior in age, as an adviser, and both for the safety of Sicily, with absolute power, calling them, as they say, tyrants. Now, whether anyone is willing to think that a divine fortune and a god, or the talents of the rulers, or both, together with the citizens of that time, were the cause of the safety of Sicily, let this be as he conceives. Safety, however, did take place to the men of that time. As, then, they were in such a state, it was surely just to return thanks to their preservers. But if the tyranny did, in after times, use somewhat improperly the gift of the city, for this it has partly had accusations against it, and let it partly suffer the punishment. But what accusations would have been necessarily correct after what had occurred to them? For if you had been able to escape from them easily and without great danger and trouble, or they to recover easily again their power, it would not have been possible to give the advice about to be spoken. But now it is requisite for both of you to bear and call to mind how often each of you have been in the hope of fancying yourselves to want only a mere trifle towards the accomplishment of everything according to your mind. Now, this very trifle happens on each occasion to be the cause of great and numberless mischiefs, nor has yet any end been reached, but the old end seems to be ever combining with a new beginning, and by this circle of events the whole of the tyrannic and popular kind of government will be near to be destroyed, and the whole of Sicily, should some event probable but to be deprecated take place, will come to nearly a desert as regards the language of Greece, by being transferred to some Phoenician or Opic dynasty in power. Against this it is requisite for all the Greeks, with all readiness, to prepare a remedy. Now, if any one has anything more correct and better than what will be said by myself, let him bring it forward, and be justly called a lover of Greece. But what now presents itself to me, I will, with all freedom of speech, and making use of a mediatory and just discourse, endeavor to point out. I declare, then, speaking in the manner of an arbitrator, to two persons, one ruling over, and the other ruled by, a tyrant, my old advice, as if given to each singly. And now, my language of advice would be for every tyrant to fly from the name and the thing itself, and to change his power as a tyrant, if possible, into that of a king. And possible it is, as the wise and good Lycurgus showed by his acts, who, on seeing that the family of his relations in Argos and Messene had proceeded from kings to tyrants, and had been destroying both themselves and each his own city, felt a fear both for his country and race, and applied as a remedy the government of elderly men and the bond of the ephori as a preservative of kingly rule, so that it has been preserved for so many generations with glory, since law became the lord and authorized king of men, and not men the tyrants over the laws. To this my discourse now exhorts all men, aiming at tyranny, that they turn away themselves, and fly with celerity, from the felicity of men insatiably hungry and without mind, and that they endeavor to come round to a form of kingly government, and to become subservient to laws made by a king, and thus to obtain the greatest honors with the consent both of men and laws. But those who are in the pursuit of free institutions and are flying from a servile yoke as an evil, I would advise to be cautious lest, through an insatiable desire for unreasonable liberty, they fall at some time into the disease of their ancestors, which the persons of that period suffered through an excessive anarchy for making a bad use of their measureless love of freedom. For the Siceliots, who possessed the power before Dionysius and Hipparinus, lived, as they thought, happily, because they lived luxuriously and ruled over even rulers themselves. For they pelted and stoned to death the 10 military chiefs prior to Dionysius, having judged them according to no law, in order that they might not be the slaves of anyone, either with justice or law as the despot, but be in every way entirely free. From hence arose the tyrannies over them, for slavery and freedom, when excessive, are each an evil, but when moderate, altogether a good. For moderate is the slavery to a god, but that to a man immoderate, and to temperate men God is a law, but to the intemperate pleasure. Since then, such is naturally the case, what I am advising, I exhort the friends of Dion to proclaim to all the Syracusans as the common advice of Dion and myself. But I will interpret what, had he been living and able, he would have said to you. What, then, was the reasoning, some one may say, which the advice of Dion shows forth to us touching the present state of affairs? It was this, quote, "Receive, O Syracusians, before all things, such laws as appear to you, not about to turn your thoughts or desires to money-making and wealth, but as there are three things, soul, body, and moreover wealth, put the worth of the soul in the place of highest honor, that of the body in the second, but under the soul, but in the third and last, that of wealth, as being the slave both of the body and soul. Now, the institution that affects this will be a law rightly laid down by you, and render those who make use of it truly happy. But the language which calls the rich happy is itself unhappy, as being the senseless language of women and children, and it makes those who are persuaded of it of the same kind. Now, that I am exhorting you to what is true, you will know in fact, if you shall try what has now been said by me on the subject of laws, by having received such laws which appears to be the truest test in all cases. For since danger is keeping down Sicily, and you are neither sufficiently the conquerors, nor manifestly the conquered, it will perhaps be just and conducive to all of you to take a middle path, both those who are flying from the severity of power, and those who desire to have it again, the ancestors of whom did in their time what is a thing of the greatest moment, preserve the Greeks from the barbarians, so that it is now lawful to hold discourse about a form of government. For had they perished then, there would have been left nowhere, nor anyhow, either discourse or hope. Now then, let there be to some a liberty combined with kingly government, but to others a kingly government under control, by the laws having a despotic power, not only over the other citizens, but over the kings themselves, should they act contrary to the law. And in addition to all this, do ye, together with the gods, in a spirit guileless and sincere, appoint a king, first my own son, on account of twofold favors for myself and father. For he at that period freed the city from the barbarians, but I have now done so twice from tyrants, as yourselves are the witnesses. And make him the second king, who has the same name as his own father, I mean the son of Dionysius, for the sake of the assistance which he now affords, and of his pious conduct, who, born from a father who was a tyrant, has voluntarily made the city free, and obtained for himself and his race ever-living honor, instead of a tyranny lasting for a day, and at the same time unjust. To become the third king of Syracuse, it is proper to invite Dionysius, the son of Dionysius, if willing, over a willing city, who is now the general of the enemy's army, if he will consent of his own accord to change himself into the form of a king, while fearing his fortunes and commiserating his country, and the want of attention shown to sacred rites and sepulchres, and lest, through a love of contention, he shall destroy everything in every way, and become an object for barbarians to rejoice over. These three kings do ye, whether giving or depriving them of the power they possess at Lacedaemon, by common consent establish after some such manner as this, which has indeed been mentioned to you before, but still do ye hear it now again. If the family of Dionysius and Hipparinus are willing for the safety of Sicily to cease from their present ills and to obtain honor for themselves and family, both for the future and the present time, on this condition call them, as I have said before, to power, appointing as ambassadors with full powers for the reconciliation whomsoever they wish, whether they are from their own country, or strangers, or both, and as many as they shall agree to. And let it be for them, on their arrival, first, to lay down laws, and a form of government, such that in it the kings are to be with full power over things sacred, and whatever else it is fitting for those who are the benefactors of their country, and to make guardians 35 in number of the laws, and for these, together with the people and senate, to have the rule on questions of war and peace, and to establish different courts of justice, some for one purpose, and others for others, but for the 35 guardians of the laws to be the judges of death and banishment, and that in addition to these, for jurymen to be chosen from those who, during the last year, have been in office, one from each office, who may have been voted the best and most upright, and that these, during the following year, are to decide on such points as relate to the death and imprisonment and removal of the citizens, but for the king to be not permitted to be a juryman in such matters as being a priest and undefiled by murder, bonds, and banishment. These things I, when living, intended to take place for your benefit, and so I intend now, and then indeed, after having with you overcome my enemies, I should, had not foreign furies prevented me, established matters in the way I intended, and subsequently, if deeds had followed upon thoughts, I would have colonized the rest of Sicily, after depriving the barbarians of the land which they now occupy, with the exception of such as had fought for a common liberty against tyranny, and I would have reinstated the former inhabitants of Grecian places in their ancient and paternal abodes. The very same things do I even now advise you to think upon and to execute, and to invite all to these doings, but to consider the person who is unwilling to do aught as a common enemy. Nor is this impossible, for he who judges those things to be impossible, which happen to be in the souls of two persons, and which it is easy to discover from reasoning are the best, does not think correctly. Now, by the two, I mean the soul of Hipparinus, the son of Dionysius, and that of my son. For if these two agree together, to the rest of the Syracusans, and all who have any care for their country, I think the same things will appear to be correct. But paying to all the gods honors combined with prayers, and to others also, whom it is proper, together with the gods, do ye persuade and exhort both friends and those at variance, gently, and altogether, nor stand apart, until what has now been stated by us, like God-sent dreams, standing over those awake, you shall work out clearly, and bring to a happy end. Close quote. Epistle 9. Plato to Archytas of Tarentum. Prosperity. Archippus and Philonides have come to us, bringing with them the letter which you gave them, and relating the state of your affairs. Such things, then, as appertain to the city, they have accomplished without difficulty, for they were not in every respect laborious. But as to what relates to yourself, they said that you bear it ill in not being able to be released from your close attention to public affairs. Now, that it is indeed the most pleasant thing in life for a man to attend to his own affairs, especially if he chooses to do what you are doing, is evident nearly to everyone. But you ought also to consider this, that each of us is not born for himself alone, but that our country claims one part of our birth, our parents another, and our friends the remainder. Much, too, is given to the occasions that overtake us in life. Since, then, your country calls you to public affairs, it would perhaps be absurd not to hearken. For at the same time, too, it happens that you leave a place for inferior men who take the road to politics, not for the best. But of these things enough. At present we are taking care of Echecrates, and shall do so for the remainder of the time, both for your sake and that of his father, Phrynion, and of the young man himself. Epistle 10. Plato to Aristodorus. Prosperity. I hear that you are now amongst the chief of the friends of Dion, and have been all through exhibiting a conduct the most wise in things relating to philosophy. For I assert that firmness, fidelity, and integrity is true philosophy. But as to the rest of wisdom and skill, which tend to other things, I conceive that by calling them elegant subtleties, I am giving them a correct appellation. But now, farewell, and abide in the conduct in which you are now abiding. Epistle 11. Plato to Laodamas. Prosperity. I have written to you before that your coming to Athens makes a great difference with respect to all you say. But since you assert it is impossible, the second step after this is for myself to come, if possible, or Socrates, as you have said in your letter. Socrates, however, at present labors under the infirmity of a stranguary, and it would be unseemly in me to come and not accomplish that for which you are inviting me. But that such will take place, I have not great hopes. But why I say so would require a long letter, were I to go through all the reasons. Moreover, I am, on account of my age, not sufficiently well in body to be wandering about and to risk the dangers which a person meets with by land and sea. And at the present, everything in traveling is full of danger. I have it, however, in my power to advise you and the colonists what Hesiod, through me, as the relator says: to fancy is easy, to think deep is hard. For if they fancy that a city can be ever well put into order by the mere laying down of any laws whatever, without some person in authority having the care of the daily manner of living in the city, in order that it may be, in the case both of slaves and of freeborn, temperate and manly, they do not think correctly. But if there are persons worthy of this very office, this should take place. But if there is a need of some one to instruct them, I think there are not amongst you either a person to teach or those to be taught. It remains, then, for you to pray to the gods. For nearly in this way have cities in former times been put into order, and subsequently well administered, during the concurrence of matters of great moment, which have happened amidst war and other transactions, when a man shall have arisen on such occasions with bodily and mental qualifications, and in the possession of large powers. But previously it is meet to feel a readiness to act, and it is necessary to think deeply upon what I am saying, and not to behave sillily through thinking that you can do anything offhand. Be good fortune thine. Epistle 12. Plato to Archytas of Tarentum. Prosperity. How wonderfully delighted did we receive the memorials which came from you, and admired in the greatest possible manner everything of the writers. To us he appeared a man worthy of his celebrated ancestors, for they are said to have been 10,000 in number, and they were, as the story handed down declares, the best of all those Trojans who, during the reign of Laomedon, removed themselves from their native land. With respect to the memorials in my possession, about which you have sent to me, they are not yet in a sufficient state. However, such as they are, I have sent them to you. With respect to the safe cure of them, we are of one mind, so that there is no need of exhortation. Epistle 13. Plato to Dionysius, tyrant of Syracuse. Prosperity. Let the commencement of the letter, and at the same time the symbol, be that it is from me. When you were once feasting some young men of Locri, and were reclining at table at a distance from myself, you rose up and came to me, and courteously addressed to me a kind word, as it seemed to me, and to the person reclining by me. Now, he was one of the handsome youths who said at that time, "Surely, Dionysius, you are benefited much with respect to wisdom by Plato." Whereupon you observed, "And with respect to many other things, especially since the time of my sending for him, through this very thing, because I had sent for him, I have been benefited forthwith." This, then, I must keep in mind, in order that our mutual benefit may be to us ever on the increase. And, in preparation for this event, I am sending a person of the Pythagorean and the divisions, as it seemed to me then, of whom both you and Archytas, if indeed Archytas has come to you, will be able to make use. His name is Helicon, his family is of Cusicum, and he is a disciple of Eudoxus, with all of whose doctrines he is elegantly conversant. And, still further, he has associated with one of the disciples of Isocrates, and with Polixenus, one of the friends of Bruson, and, what is moreover a rare thing, he is neither disagreeable to meet with, nor like an ill-mannered person, but would seem rather to be volatile and of an easy temper. I say this, however, with some fear, as I am expressing an opinion respecting a man who is no mean an animal, and one easily changed, except in the case of some few persons, and on a few points. And, with respect to him, I am thinking with fear, and without confidence, as I have met with him myself, and made inquiry of his fellow citizens, and not one of them has said a bad word against the man. Do you, therefore, reflect yourself and exercise caution, but above all things, take lessons from him, and study philosophy upon any other points, if you have any leisure. But if not, set him to teach someone, so that you may, when at leisure, by learning become better, and in good repute, in order that, in your being benefited by myself, there may be, in your case, no remission. With regard to the articles you bade me send you, I have cause to be made the Apollo, which Leptines is bringing, by a young and clever workman. His name is Leocharis. There was another work by him, very elegant, as it appeared to me. I therefore purchased it, wishing to present it to your wife, because she had attended me, both in health and sickness, in a manner worthy of me and you. Present it, then, to her, unless it seems otherwise good to you. I send you likewise 12 jars of sweet wine for your children, and 2 of honey, but I came too late for putting up the dried figs, and all the myrtles that had been put up for you have rotted. I will, however, take better care at another time. Leptines will tell you about the plants. The money in silver for these things, and for the contributions of some persons to the state, I have received from Leptines, and told him what appears to me to be the most becoming and true estate, that what I had expended on the Leucadian vessel, amounting to nearly 11 minae, was mine. This, therefore, I have taken, and after taking, I have made use of it myself, and I have sent away these to you. As to what follows with regard to the money, hear how the case stands. I shall make use of your money as I told you then, in the same way as I do that of my other acquaintances, but I use it in as small quantities as possible, for such things as seem to be necessary, or just, or becoming to myself, or to the person from whom I may receive it. Now, something of this kind has happened to me. Of my nieces, who died at the period when I was not crowned, although you had ordered it, there are 4 daughters living. One is of a marriageable age, another 18 years old, another a little more than 3 years old, and another not yet 1 year old. All these it will be for myself and friends to give out in marriage, should I survive them. But let those whom I do not survive fare as they may, while for those whose fathers may become richer than myself, I shall not have to provide. At present, however, my means are greater than theirs, for the marriage of their mothers likewise I have provided with the aid of others, and of Dion. One of them is married to Speusippus, of whose sister she is the daughter. For this one there is need of not more than 30 minae, since the marriage portions given by myself are moderate. Moreover, should my mother die, there would be need of not more than 10 minae for erecting her tomb. Such are the sums requisite at present for what are almost necessaries. But should any other expense occur of a private or public nature through my coming to you, it will be requisite, as I stated then, for me to labor and to make a vigorous effort for the expenditure to be the least possible, but where I am unable to do aught, for the expense to be yours. What I mean after this, touching the expenditure, on the other hand, of your money at Athens, is in the first place this, that should it be needful for me to expend anything on a corrigi, or any office of that kind, there is no friend of yours here who will advance it for you, as I imagine, since, even if it made a great difference to you that a sum would, if expended, be a benefit to you, but an injury if it were not expended and delayed, until someone should arrive from yourself, such a circumstance would turn out disgraceful in addition to its being detrimental. For of this I have a proof by having sent Erastus to Andromedes of Aegina, from whom, as being your friend, you ordered me to get what I wanted, as you wished him to send, even more than you had stated by letter. But he said, what was reasonable, and as any person would do, that he had previously laid out money for your father, and had with difficulty got it back again, and that he would now advance a small sum, but nothing more. Thus I received a something from Leptines, and for this it is proper to praise Leptines, not only for having advanced the money, but for doing so readily, and he was in other respects, by speaking of you, and performing what he could, evidently a friend to your interests. For it is meet, respecting such matters and the contrary, for me to tell you in what light each person has appeared to me, as regards yourself. On the subject of money, at least, I shall speak with freedom, for it is just, and at the same time I shall be speaking about persons near you, of whom I have some experience, who, after previously stating on each occasion what they think they shall expend for you, do not subsequently mention the subject, as if, forsooth, they should be disagreeable to you. Do you, then, accustom them, and even compel them to speak upon these points and others too, for you ought to know the whole as far as you can, and to be a judge, and not to fly from knowing, for this will be the best for your government. For, as regards other things, and the possession itself of money, you too have said, and will say, that it is good to know that the expenditure is made correctly, and correctly accounted for. Let not, then, those who profess to care for you bring a reproach upon yourself in the eyes of mankind, for this appears to be neither good nor fair to your reputation in the case of your agreements. In what follows I shall speak of Dion. Upon other points I am not able to speak before the letters which you have mentioned arrive from yourself. But upon those which you did not permit me to mention to him, I have mentioned nothing, nor conversed at all. I have merely tried whether he bears ill or easily what is reported, and it seems to me that he will not brook it quietly if it should turn out a fact. But in other respects Dion appears to me to use moderation both in word and deed. Let us present to Cratinus, the brother of Timotheus, and my friend, a breastplate of the handsome kind worn by the heavy armed foot soldiers, and to the daughters of Cebes, 3 outer dresses, 7 cubits long, not, however, of the expensive kind from Amorgus, but of Sicilian linen. With the name of Cebes you are duly acquainted, for he is mentioned in the Socratic dialogues as holding, together with Simmias, a conversation with Socrates in the dialogue respecting the soul, and as a man of the same clique with, and well disposed to, all of us. Of the symbol relating to my letters, I think you have a recollection, touching such as I write with care, and such as I do not. Nevertheless, reflect upon it, and bear it in mind. For many persons insist upon my writing, whom it is not easy to put off. The more important letter, a god commences, but the less, gods. The ambassadors, likewise, have requested me to write, as was natural, for they very heartily praise both you and me everywhere, and, not the least, Philagrus, who at that time had something the matter with his hand, and Philidas, who has come from the great king, has spoken about you. And if I had not had matter for a long letter, I would have written down what he said. But at present, inquire of Leptines. should you send the breastplate or anything else about which I have written, entrust them to any wish, or otherwise to Terulus. He is one of those who is continually sailing to and fro, and is attached to myself, and upon other subjects, and those two relating to philosophy, is a person of elegant mind, and is a relation of Tison, who was, at the time when I sailed away, the prefect of the city. May you increase in health and philosophy, and convert others, who are younger, to it, and embrace for me all our fellow Sphyrists, and enjoin the others, and Aristocritus, should any message or letter arrive relating to you, that they take care you know of it as quickly as possible, and that they put you in mind of it, in order that you may attend to the matter mentioned in the letters. And, for the present, do not neglect the repayment of the money to Leptines, but repay it as quickly as possible, so that others, looking to him, may be the more ready to minister to myself. Eutrocles, who at that time was, together with Muranides, dismissed as a freedman by myself, sails now with the things sent by me. Keep him in your pay as being well disposed towards you, and make use of him in any way you please. And know yourself either the letter itself, or if a memorandum of it is preserved. End of Epistles.